Yes, students, in today's class we'll try to learn about how blood pressure is regulated. So there can be immediate mechanisms, short-term mechanisms or long-term mechanisms. They're also called as short-term mechanism, intermediate-term mechanism and long-term mechanism. Short-term regulatory mechanism, they're mainly neural mechanisms which are called as baroreceptor reflexes, chemoreceptor reflexes and cerebral ischemic response. Baroreceptor reflex is also called as Mary's reflex. This reflex consists of receptors, afferent, centers and the effector. Okay, so here the receptors which are the baroreceptors which are present on the aortic and carotid sinuses. So whenever there is an increase in the blood pressure, so these baroreceptors are stimulated, the information is brought to the cardiovascular regulatory centers through the hearing and vagus nerve. Okay, so here the information is processed by the sensory area, which is called as nucleus tractus ambiguus, and it in turn it facilitates the cardiac inhibitory centers, and it is going to inhibit vasomotor center. Okay, so inhibition of vasomotor center will lead to decrease in the blood pressure, and facilitation of the cardiac inhibitory center is going to increase the vagal tone. Okay, so that is going to reduce the blood pressure. So that is baroreceptor reflex. So conversely, whenever there is a decrease in the blood pressure, the baroreceptors are not stimulated, the information will not go to the sensory area. So VMC is not inhibited, cardiac inhibitory center is not facilitated. So there is increase in the sympathetic drive that is going to increase the blood pressure, and the inhibition of the cardiac inhibitory center increases the heart rate. Okay, so again, this is the Mary's reflex or sinoaortic reflex. So stimulation of the baroreceptor through carotid and aortic arch, so that the information goes to the tractus solitarius, so that leads to inhibition of the vasomotor center, that decreases the sympathetic drive. Okay, so there will be vasodilatation and venodilation, which is going to decrease the blood pressure. So on the other hand, it leads to stimulation of the cardiac inhibitory center, which is nothing but nucleus ambiguus, the motor part of the vagus. Okay, so the vagal tone is increased, heart rate is decreased, so the heart rate is going to come down. So the net effect of the baroreceptor reflex is there is a decreased peripheral resistance, there is a decreased myocardial contractility, there is a decreased heart rate, and there is a decrease in the blood pressure. So baroreceptor reflex works at the blood pressure of 90 to 120 mmHg, and it happens within a few seconds. Okay, whereas chemoreceptor reflexes, it occurs when blood pressure falls less than 60 mmHg and up to 30 mmHg. Okay, so it operates in that range. So when there is hypoxia, the chemoreceptors are stimulated, which are there in the aortic and carotid bodies, and the information goes to the nucleus tractus solitarius, that stimulates the vasomotor center, so that facilitates the sympathetic drive. Okay, so at the same time, nucleus ambiguus is inhibited. Cardiac inhibitory centers are facilitated, so there will be activation of the vagus that reduces the vagal tone. Okay, so this reflex operates at the range of 30 to 60 mmHg. Then the next is cerebral ischemic response when blood pressure falls less than 30 mmHg. Okay, So this is also called as last ditch response. Okay. So for example, when there is an intracranial pressure, okay, so there will be a reduced perfusion to the vasomotor center. Okay, so that causes cerebral hypoxia, and also there is a direct effect on the vasomotor centers. So there is an ischemia to the vasomotor center that stimulates the vasomotor center and causes the vasoconstriction and increase in the blood pressure. Okay, and this increase in the blood pressure through the baroreceptor reflex reflexly decreases the heart rate. Okay, so the ultimate result will be when there is an intracranial increased pressure, there will be increase in the blood pressure, and that will be associated with bradycardia. Okay, and this is called as Cushing's reflex. So these are the shorter mechanisms. Okay, so other type is delayed or intermediate mechanism. Okay, so in that the capillary fluid shift phenomenon plays an important role. So whenever there is an increase in blood pressure, more fluid is filtered through the capillary wall into the interstitial space. Okay, so because of the hydrostatic increase in the hydrostatic pressure, the fluid moves from the capillary wall into the interstitial space, so the blood volume decreases and that reduces the blood pressure. Okay, so it may take over a period of days. Okay, and the reverse changes takes place when the BP falls. So when BP falls, hydrostatic pressure decreases, there will be pressure gradient from the interstitial space, the fluid moves from interstitial fluid back into the capillaries to restore the blood pressure. So, renin-angiotensin system. So whenever there is a fall in blood pressure, there is a decrease in the blood flow in the kidney. Okay, so this results in ischemic kidney, and renin is released from JJ cells. So there is also, whenever there is a hypotension, okay, so there will be decreased load of sodium chloride in the renal tubules, and that stimulates the macula densa, and that in turn increases the production of renin from juxtaglomerular cells. Okay, so thus released renin converts angiotensin into angiotensin 1 in the kidney. Okay, and angiotensin 1 gets converted into angiotensin 2, so when it goes to the pulmonary circulation, where we have abundant angiotensin converting enzyme. Okay, and this angiotensin 2 has a various effect. Okay, so importantly, it causes vasoconstriction, peripheral vasoconstriction, and thus increases the blood pressure. It also increases the stimulate the production of aldosterone from the adrenal cortex, and aldosterone is a potent mineral corticoid that conserves sodium and water. Then stimulation of the thirst center leads to increased water intake that expands the ECF volume, increase absorption of the sodium by PCT by direct effect. Okay, so angiotensin has a direct effect on the renal tubules, proximal converted tubules, that increases the absorption of the sodium. So that's how the blood volume increases, so the cardiac output, and so the blood pressure. So when blood pressure decreases, or there is a reduced blood flow to the kidney, so it affects the juxtaglomerular apparatus, renin is produced. Then with the effect of renin, angiotensin 1 is produced. In the lungs, angiotensin 2 is produced that acts on the adrenal cortex to produce aldosterone that increases, that conserves the salt and water, and also it is a potent vasoconstrictor. So ultimately the blood pressure increases by renin angiotensin system. So another long term mechanism is stress relaxation. So whenever there is increase in the blood pressure, the blood vessels are stretched, and that leads to stretch relaxation. So that increases the capacity of the vessels. So the effective, there will be decreased effective blood volume. So that decreases the blood pressure. And obviously, the opposite is going to happen when blood pressure is going to reduce. So the long-term mechanisms, they're mainly involved in increase in the blood volume. Okay, so this renal body fluid system, fluid shift mechanism, it's another long-term mechanism where it will restore the blood pressure if it is altered. So whenever there is an increase in the ECF or blood volume, that is going to lead to increase in the blood pressure. So that in turn is going to increase GFR and increased urine output. So thus the BP is brought back to the normal level. Okay, so this you can call it as water diuresis or pressure diuresis, and also there can be a nitrate diuresis. That is our body loses excess of water also with losing of excess of sodium from the kidney. So that is called as pressure nitriuresis. Exactly opposite thing is going to happen when ECF is reduced or blood volume is reduced. So that leads to decrease in the blood pressure, that reduces the GFR and decreases the urine output. So the BP slowly raises to the normal level. Okay, so there won't be a pressure diuresis, nitriuresis. So that is going to conserve sodium and BP is slowly raised to the normal levels. Hormonal regulations. Okay, so there are many hormones which are going to affect the blood pressure. Catecholamines mainly acts on the heart and the vessels, mainly act on the heart through the beta 1 receptors. They increases the cardiac myocontractility. Okay, mineral corticoid mainly conserves water and sodium, thus expands the ECF, increases the blood pressure. Glucocorticoids can act in the same way by conserving sodium. Thyroxine is potent myocardial stimulator. ADH conserves the water. Atrial nitrate, uretic peptide, it leads to loss of sodium and hence it leads to hypotension, reduction in the blood pressure. Nitric oxide, a potent vasodilator, decreases the blood pressure. Histamine increases the permeability of the capillaries. So it helps in the decrease, the facilitation of the fluid from the capillary to the interstitium, and hence it decreases the the ECF volume. Angiotensin, it is a potent vasoconstrictor, increases the blood pressure. Serotonin is a local vasoconstrictor, and hence it increases the blood pressure. Okay, so these are some of the hormones, which helps in the regulation of the blood pressure. Coming to some of the applied aspects, hypertension. So hypertension is defined as elevation of systolic blood pressure. Persistent hypertension is very common. 30% of the people over 50 are hypertensive. Hypertension should not be diagnosed on one reading. It indicates their existing cardiovascular disease process, and it could be because of the side effect of some of the medications. So when BP, blood pressure, is more than 140 and diastolic more than 190 mmHg, then it is called as hypertension. So it can be a primary or essential hypertension, or it can be secondary. Primary, where the cause is not known, so that is why it is called as idiopathic. Okay, so where in secondary hypertension there is a particular cause, like endocrine disease or cardiovascular diseases. Okay, so diseases which are attributed to the hypertension. So hypertension mainly it affects the vascular system, combined with the vascular disease like atherosclerosis, and it is going to damage various organs. Okay, and thus it can lead to stroke, heart failure, cerebral hemorrhages, chronic kidney failure, hypertensive encephalopathy, retinopathy, peripheral vascular disease like Burgess disease, aortic aneurysm, left ventricular hypertrophy, myocardial infarction, coronary heart disease, and heart failure. So some of the predisposing factors for the primary hypertension are like obesity, hereditary causes, alcoholism, stress, smoking, and sedentary lifestyle. Secondary hypertension, I mean, as I said, the cause is known. So it could be because of the renal disease or endocrinal disease or vascular disease. Okay, so in renal, acute and chronic glomerulonephritis, I mean, they can cause the renal ischemia, and they will lead to the increased activation of the angiotensin mechanism and increase the blood pressure. Okay, and particularly renal artery stenosis, the hypoxia to the renal tissue will lead to the activation of renin angiotensin mechanism, and it leads to secondary hypertension. So endocrine causes like increased the glucocorticoid levels, which occurs in Cushing's disease, hyperaldosteronism, which is called as Crohn's disease, and increased thyroid hormones, which is called as thyrotoxicosis, and pheochromocytoma, where there is elevated levels of catecholamines, so that will lead to increase in the blood pressure. Okay, and vascular diseases like atherosclerosis and arteriosclerosis, particularly if atherosclerosis or arteriosclerosis occurs in the renal vessel, that will lead to secondary hypertension. So how do you treat the hypertension? So mainly because the 90% of the hypertension is because of idiopathy, so the modification of the lifestyle is essential, by cessation of smoking, moderation in alcohol intake, weight reduction, programmed exercise, reduction in the sodium intake, taking diet which is high in potassium, relaxation techniques like yoga and trance meditation. And some of the medications which are used for hypertension are diuretics. They decrease the urine volume, beta blockers mainly by decreasing the heart rate, calcium antagonists mainly blocking the calcium channels, ACE inhibitors inhibiting the conversion of angiotensin 1 into angiotensin 2, and angiotensin 2 receptor blockers are used for the treatment modalities of hypertension. So how do you prevent hypertension? Reduce the risk of developing high blood pressure by making lifestyle changes. Eat a healthy and well-balanced diet. Reduce salt and fat intake. Exercise regularly. Stop smoking. Reduce alcohol and caffeine consumption to recommended levels, and reduce weight. Hypotension is defined in adults as a systolic blood pressure less than 90 mmHg. So rarely it is treated in this country. So what are the causes for hypotension? Mainly the hemorrhage, dehydration, omitting and diarrhea, excessive sweating, Addison's disease, and hypothyroidism are the main causes for hypotension. So how do you treat hypotension? Treat the cause first, then do blood transfusion, treat with IV fluids, and if possible, the vasoconstrictors. Okay. So that is all about the applied aspects of the blood pressure, that is